Cunder's expression board lets you add custom functionality to your analyses. Using Spark SQL expressions, you can derive new columns, filter data, and perform aggregations in ways that would be cumbersome or just not possible with Cunder's other boards. In this tutorial, we'll see how to use Cunder's expression board through a few examples that you can apply to your own analyses. Let's start by adding an expression board. It's available under the Suggested, Filter, Transform, and Edit column menus. You can also add it by typing Control-B on Windows or Command-B on Mac and searching for the expression board. You'll see the expression library pane by default, so click either the Editor tab or Write New Expression. Now, many people, when they see this box with SQL autocompletion, start typing an entire query, and that doesn't work. It's worth pausing to explore why. One reason it doesn't work is that they use the syntax of whatever SQL dialect they're used to. For example, MS SQL, MySQL, Postgres, etc., they all have slightly different ways of writing the same command, so you need to take those syntax differences into account. Cunder uses Spark SQL, and you can find reference docs both within the Cunder expression board under the Help button, in the Palantir Foundry docs, and the Apache Spark docs. The other reason their SQL doesn't work is that Cunder expression board accepts only SQL expressions, not SQL statements. Here's an example of a SQL statement. SQL expressions are parts of the statement. A statement can contain multiple expressions, and each expression can produce a scalar value, for example, a number, a boolean, a string, etc., or a table, such as when you have a subquery. So just to take a simple example, if we wanted to add a new column where the point of sale column values are uppercase, we would just write the expression upper point of sale instead of writing the whole SQL statement. And we would also have to give it a name. Of course, in this case, it would probably make more sense to replace the point of sale column instead. Before we get into more complicated expressions, here are a few quick tips to make using the Cunder expression board a bit easier. Double quotes are for column names and single quotes are for strings in your expressions. If you don't put quotes around your column names, that will still work, but if you use double quotes for anything else, then there'll be an error. When typing, hit Tab to accept any of the auto suggestions. There's no auto formatter, so you're best off using your IDE or text editor of choice for that. I like VS Code with any one of the popular SQL plugins. You can add comments with a standard double dash syntax. You can use common code editor shortcuts in the SQL editor, such as Alt-Shift-Down to duplicate the line your cursor is currently on. Now let's move on to some more realistic expressions. Let's say we want to reclassify the point of sale values into broader categories. We could do that with a case when expression. For example, when the point of sale has the word online preceding any other words, then replace it with just online. And when it has the word entrance after any other characters, then replace it with park entrance. Otherwise, we'll just leave it as third party. Let's say we wanted to compute how much revenue was generated by ticket sales by location. For that, we would reach for window functions. Let's break down what's going on in this expression. The sum of price is pretty straightforward. We're just adding up values of the price column. The over clause is where it starts to get more interesting. It modifies how the sum of price expression behaves. First, we have partition by point of sale, which specifies that we want to compute the sum not for all rows at the same time, but on a group by group basis. And the way we create the groups is by the values of the point of sale column. So, the categories we just made, such as online or third party or park entrance. This is very similar to group by in SQL, except we're not aggregating the table. That is, we're not changing the shape of the data apart from adding a new column. We keep the same number of rows we started with. The order by entrance date ascending specifies that we want to compute the sum with a particular order of rows in mind. This matters for the last line, rows between unbounded preceding and current row. All that means is when computing the sum for a given row, include all the rows before it, the row itself, but none of the rows after it. Lastly, I'm rounding the whole expression. This was just because my column is a double and that's not the most convenient type for currencies, and I wanted it to look nice on screen. I could have multiplied by 100 and cast price to an integer before summing it, and then divided by 100 when I was done to get back to cents. That might be a bit more accurate. However, I wanted to use the round function because it clearly illustrates something. And that's that the entire window expression is really just one expression. It's like a lot of words, but it's just one expression. I think you might be tempted to try doing round of sum of price over the rest of the partition, but that would result in an error. The round function can't be used to compute aggregates like a cumulative sum. So you have to round the entire window function. To see another example of window functions, let's get the most recent time a guest entered the park. This expression is similar to the previous one, except we're using the last function, which gets the last row for a given group, or partition. Contour is giving us a warning that using the window function last may lead to non-deterministic behavior. And all this means is that if you sort the data by a column where there are duplicate values within one partition, then it's just impossible to reliably give you the same order of rows if you rerun this analysis. So the way to mitigate this is just make sure your sorting logic yields only one valid possible order of rows. Unfortunately, we can't use a window function in a filter, so in order to filter this, we'll need to add one more board. For filter expressions, your expression needs to evaluate to a truthy value, a Boolean, essentially, true or false. Here, I'm specifying that the most recent entrance column that I just created must equal the entrance date column. We've covered adding columns, replacing columns, and filtering. The last option for the expression board is aggregations. For example, if I want to understand the average time of day people entered the park according to where they bought their ticket, I would reach for an aggregation. Aggregations act just like a group by in SQL. Up top, you have the group by field where you add the columns whose values you want to calculate an aggregate for. In this case, it's the point of sale column. You can add as many grouping columns as you need, and there will be one row for each unique combination of values across these columns. Below that is the aggregates field, where you specify your aggregation expression. Here, I'm taking the hours and minutes of the entrance date column, converting them to hours, taking the average, and then rounding it. And that gets me the average entrance time in hours for each group. You can add as many aggregations as you'd like, and they could be different functions. For example, I could get, the standard deviation or the variance of this, or I could compute an entirely different aggregation for a different column. Here's what a comparable SQL statement would be. Okay, let's do a more complicated expression now. And to be clear, at this point we're entering the land of just because you can doesn't mean you should. Let's create an expression that calculates a two-sample independent t-statistic. Now, to be clear, there are better ways of doing this in Foundry. R and Python come with this out of the box, and you can use those in code workspaces, code workbooks, or code repositories. But if you're not familiar with R or Python, or if you're just already in Contour, this could be a good option for you. It's going to be a two-step process. First, we'll calculate the aggregations we need to use in the t-statistic formula, and then we'll run the formula itself. Let's imagine that we want to see if the people who bought their tickets online had a significantly different entrance time from the people who bought their tickets at the park. According to Wikipedia, the formula for a t-statistic is this. We want to calculate the means, variance, and counts for each group, one group being the people who bought their tickets online, and the other group being the people who bought their tickets at the park entrance. We've got two ways of doing this, one being the pivot table, and if you're just doing this once, that's probably the faster option. The other option is the expression board, and since this tutorial is about the expression board, we're going to use that. We'll calculate six aggregations, mean for both groups, variance for both groups, and row count for both groups. And I guess since this is a two-sample t-statistic, we're supposed to assume that the sample sizes between each group is about the same, so we could get away with five, but for completeness' sake, we'll calculate all six. And we're doing a little bit of an interesting thing where I said before you can't use window functions in filters, but you can kind of filter window functions. What I'm doing here is using a case when statement to assign null to rows where I don't want that value computed as part of the aggregate. So for example, in this case, I'm saying if the point of sale category is equal to park entrance, then get me the time. But if it's not, then just get me a null value. And so when I calculate the mean over that, it's just going to calculate the mean for the park entrance values. The result is a one-row table with the values we need to calculate the t-statistic with. Then we add a second expression that calculates the t-statistic according to the formula shown above. Now, again, I'm not sure this is the best idea because there are much better ways of doing more advanced statistical analysis in Foundry, but I think it is useful to see how creative you can get with the expression board, especially this 1-2 step of calculating some aggregates in one step and then using those aggregates in a later step. You can accomplish some analyses that you probably thought weren't possible with Contour. You can also use contour parameters in expressions. For example, here I've created a parameter to hold the name of the online point of sale category name. I've used it in the case one expression from earlier in the path, and I've overridden the default value of online to be offline instead, just to show how it works. You use parameters by prepending a dollar sign, for example, dollar sign online category name. Saving expressions lets you and colleagues reuse them in the future. You can find them in the saved expressions library, which is the default view when you add a new expression board. When you save an expression, you need to specify what inputs it requires. For example, in the t-statistic expression I wrote, I used different columns as inputs, online variance, park entrance mean, etc. I want this to be more generally useful, so I'll rename them to something like mean group 1, mean group 2, variance group 1, and so on. You can give your saved expression a custom name, add a description, and add descriptions for each argument that future users will need to provide when using it. When you or someone else goes to use a saved expression, it will require you to assign values to the arguments, it will display the description, and show the source code of the SQL expression you wrote. Over time, you and colleagues can build up a library of useful expressions. Here are some saved expression ideas that you might find useful to add to your library. If you're in a part of the world where the first day of the week is not Sunday, but it's Monday instead, well, you can make a modified day of week expression. Another useful saved expression is a rolling aggregate, such as a rolling 1 week average. And to do this, I would use range instead of rows in my window function. Range lets you look up and down not a certain number of rows, but a certain value. Now, the one thing about range is that it needs to be an integer. So for example, if you're looking up and down a timestamp or a date column, you just need to convert that to seconds using the to Unix timestamp function. And then you've got a saved expression that can give you a rolling 1 week, or you know, you could make that an argument. It could be like a 1 week or a 1 month or some other value sliding window of a rolling aggregate. Another one is a saved expression that normalizes the values of some columns so they span between 0 and 100. You could even encode some of the Western Electric rules, such as the second one listed on this Wikipedia page here. I've included additional details about these ideas for saved expressions in the blog post that accompanies this tutorial. That wraps our tutorial on Contour's expression board. I hope you found it useful. If your organization wants to learn to use Foundry more effectively, visit ontologize.com or reach out to me on LinkedIn to learn more about our live trainings and self-serve courses. I'll see you in the next tutorial.